Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode 9 of Introductory Physics. Now, you give yourselves double pat on the back because you've made it to the end of the first season, the end of the first semester. Wow, really, congratulations. Again, we've covered a lot this semester. A plus for sticking with it and for, you know, putting in the hard work. And believe me, it will pay off. So today we talk about projectile motion and also get to touch on satellite motion, so projectile and satellite motion. And so to start, I really want to show this clip from the Artemis mission, which is set to the first mission is set to launch on the 29th of August. So when you're watching this, you probably will have already seen the results of that launch, and they may be on to many more. Just to kind of illustrate really the power of this physics, you know, literally taking us from sticks and stones to the stars. And I think it's also just great, again, to see that we sort of have this direction again, returning to space, going to the moon, going to Mars. And it's also just really fun thinking about the physics of this. You know, how does one get to the moon, right? You know, how do you get to orbit? How do you orbit? You know, all those sorts of questions. And a lot of them we won't be able to answer because we just haven't, you know, this video, we won't go through all the astrophysics necessary to understand that, but we will be able to touch on that, which would be really cool. So without further ado, let's look at the material. Okay, so projectile motion. So a projectile is a rock, a tennis ball, you know, anything that basically has its own inertia. So anything that has its own inertia and is projected by some means. So you could imagine, you know, that I take a tennis ball and I wing it across the court. That's a projectile because it has mass, it has inertia, and it's projected. I've given it a push. So, or you know, the classic example is a cannon, right? And so how do we analyze this motion? Well, we can think of sort of two simple cases, right? And I'm going to call this case one horizontal, right? You know, there's a floor and the ball is sort of rolling on the floor. Right? That's case one. Case two is going to be vertical. So, you know, I drop the ball and it's going to go down. And what if case three, we have a hybrid of horizontal and vertical. So what if I throw a ball upwards like that? And now this is a question because this case is pretty simple. This case is pretty simple, right? I just roll something or I drop it. But what about if I do both at the same time, right? Now, if we think back to vectors, right? We know that I can add them, right? So let's say that the speed of the ball is, or let's say, you know, I've thrown the ball upward with that force. Well, there's going to be a component horizontal, and I'm going to do this in different colors. So there's going to be a component that's horizontal and a component that's vertical. So basically, what this is saying is that that any motion is the sum of horizontal and or vertical components. And so what becomes a really complex problem, let's say I have a ball and I throw it, what's the path? Well, to analyze that, all I have to do is consider, well, there's some horizontal component of motion and there's some vertical component. And believe me, this is a really key idea, separating horizontal and vertical components. And we can do this because of the vectorial nature of velocity, of acceleration, of force. So, because they're vectors, right? We can do this because they're vectors. And so the combination of of the horizontal and the vertical will produce what we see. And they're independent. Vertical and horizontal components are independent. And this is really hugely important, again, because I can treat them separately. So I can reduce any case of this, anything like this, into a case one and a case two. And in case one and case two, we know what's going on, right? Either we have horizontal motion or we have vertical, right? Everything's pretty easy to understand. So, right. So we can also, so we can launch projectiles according to this path, right? So if there, let's say, is a table and I have a ball that's sort of going along, going along, going along. If there was no gravity, then that would happen, right? The ball just sort of continues going in a straight line unless acted upon by an external force. That's inertia. If it's dropped, right, it's gonna fall. This is gravity, of course, but this is from rest. This has got some initial speed. Now what if we combine these, right? So let's say I have basically this situation, but with gravity. So I have the ball, it's going like this, and then basically what we get is a nice parabola, if I could draw a bit better. So this is what we get. We get a parabola. And again, that's just simply because we're adding together the this case one of horizontal motion and the case two of vertical motion. And so at each place, we could say, okay, well, what's the vertical component, or what's the horizontal component of velocity? What's the vertical, right? And what's important to note here is actually because there's no net horizontal force, this speed is going to continue unchanged. However, there is a net vertical force. And this is gravity, right? And that's why this velocity vector here, so I'll just clarify, this is velocity. This velocity vector here, initially there's no, right, initially gravity, it's being balanced by the normal force, so there's nothing, no vertical, it's just the case one of horizontal. But after this point, after it leaves the support of the table, it's now falling. And when it's falling, it feels the force, it's being accelerated downward by gravity. And so it's going to start picking up speed as it goes, and that's why it's going to fall downward. It's not going to just keep going straight. It's going to fall downward. And it's going to trace this path of a parabola. And so what's really cool is the vertical the horizontal component will actually of speed will actually stay the same because there's no net horizontal force. However, because there's gravity, the vertical component is going to increase speed. And so the point here is that you can take this part of motion, which kind of looks weird, right? You have a parabola, you've got, what's sort of going on here? Well, just break it up into components, right? There's a horizontal component of what's going on and a vertical component. And so, yeah, so that's I think really, really important. And now, if we, we can also launch this ball at an angle, right? We could launch it like this, in which case it's going to follow a path like that, right? And again, this is because we have some horizontal component of velocity and some vertical component. So the idea is we can, and of course, if there was no gravity, we just kind of keep going up like that. So basically, we can split up motion into vertical and horizontal components. And now a question might be, well, what if I have this ball that's rolling and then falls to the ground versus a ball that I just dropped to the ground? So what if I, have like this? And these should be the same size. Well, does this ball falling here or does this one falling here reach the ground first? Well, again, the thing to remember is because I can split up the horizontal and vertical components of velocity, it doesn't matter actually that this ball is moving to the right because that velocity does not change, right? What matters is when I fall into the ground, that's a vertical thing, right? And so that matters about, well, what is the vertical speed? What's the vertical acceleration? And now because this ball has no initial vertical acceleration, it only has horizontal velocity. So it starts from rest in the vertical frame and then starts picking up speed as it goes down due to gravity. Well, that's the same as this ball, right? This ball is picking up gravity, or picking up speed because of gravity, acceleration due to gravity. And so it's actually this ball is going to fall at the same rate as that ball. Because again, the force that's acting on this ball in the vertical direction is the same as the force acting on this ball in the vertical direction. And so this is why it's super important to remember that we can split up the components of forces. Or velocity or acceleration, any vector, we can split that up into components that sum together to give us whatever result we have because we can treat each of those components separately. And so you could treat velocity in the x direction or in the y direction, force in the x direction and the y direction, and then do the analysis separately and come to the answer. And so it takes this problem of that might seem really difficult of describing this motion or which ball reaches the ground first. And now you can really easily answer that using physical principles. And that's the whole idea with physics. And so, yeah, so nothing really changes. I'm going to move this down. Nothing really changes with this example because the ball, if we can put it at different places, is going to continue to have the same vertical, sorry, the same horizontal, the x component of velocity, because there's no horizontal force, right? So no net horizontal force means no acceleration, no horizontal, right, acceleration, which means constant velocity. Constant, we should specify though, of course, horizontal velocity. So that's why here, 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 and here, the ball is moving the same in the x direction. However, in the y direction, right, unless it's like this, but then it's like this, and then here it just disappears, and then here it comes down a bit, and then down even more. But actually, if we say this is the same height, then it'll be exactly the same as this one. So, but in y, which is the vertical direction, since there is a force, there is a net force, gravity, the velocity of the ball will change. And that's why here initially we're going upward, but then gravity, of course, is acting downward. And so it's slowing me down until it stops. There's no vertical velocity. It's just sort of, it would be as if it's moving horizontally. And then it comes down. And so it starts picking up speed vertically. But again, if you can, and believe me, even I was taking AP physics as a senior in high school, and I did not really understand this idea of separating components of forces or velocity. And I was really stuck on problems. It was really hard. I wasn't understanding what was going on. But as soon as I really sat down and I understood that the key to a lot of these really complicated physics problems is figuring out, okay, well, what's happening in this direction and this direction, right? What's happening in the x direction? Let's consider all of that, all the forces or the momentum or the velocities, whatever. And then what about what's happening in the y direction? What's happening to the forces in the y direction or the velocities, whatever? And if you can really get this, that I can break any motion, any vector, right, into components and consider those components separately, then you will be so set. So I think this is really a huge, huge idea of this chapter. And so don't be hard on yourself if you don't get it right away. And the thing, of course, I want to note here as well is that this component of the vertical velocity is the same here as it is here, except it's in the opposite direction, right? It was going up, now it's going down. And that's because of conservation of energy. I've returned to the same place that I was initially, and so I shouldn't have lost any speed. Unless, of course, there's air resistance, in which case maybe the actual path, so with air resistance, the actual path, you know, might look something more like this. Let me do a better job. Try again. Right, so maybe it doesn't go quite as high and it doesn't go quite as far. And so this would be with air resistance. And then here, this would be no air resistance. And this line actually would be no gravity, right? If I just shoot the ball upwards and I'm in deep space, it's just gonna go because of inertia, right? The law of inertia, Newton's first law. If it's not acted upon by an external force, then it's just gonna keep going up in a straight line unless an external force comes along and changes it. So there you go. And now, of course, the angle that I shoot this projectile will change the path, right? So the steeper the angle, the higher it will go. But the less horizontal distance it will travel. And so you can take it sort of in the extreme case, right? You know, if I just shoot it up, so let's say here we are, right? If I shoot it horizontally in the absence of friction, it's just going to keep rolling forever. If I shoot it vertically, it's just going to go up vertically forever. And so if I, you know, if I shoot it at these different angles, you know, let's actually color. Let's color this. Maybe, you know, this one is, let's say this one is 15 degrees. And that's, just to be clear, the angle that I'm talking about is here. This angle, this initial angle of how far above the vertical I shoot off whatever the projectile is. I say that's 15, and then, you know, let's say, you know, 30 is a bit further, like that. 45. And 45 is actually, this is the angle that will get you the longest distance. Because then anything bigger, so let's try 60, will no longer fall, no longer go as far because it's going more high, right? And then finally, let's do 75. Let's just gonna move this down a little bit. Ah. You get the idea. And these are all nice parabolas. And there's a nice figure of this in your textbook, which I encourage you to check out. But this is just the idea. So this would be the sort of your horizontal distance, and this is your vertical distance. And so the thing to remember here is if you want to have the maximum, what we call range, then the range is the horizontal distance. So if you want to maximize how far it goes, and we don't, of course, we exclude the case where I just shoot it just straight across without friction, because then it's just going to go forever. But excluding friction, you know, the case where I just cheat and basically just shoot it on the ground, the maximum range will occur at 45 degrees. So, and the proof of this is a little bit tricky, involves some calculus, but the point is just to remember that if you want to maximize how far it goes, that's 45 degrees. And but this also, again, assumes no air resistance. So it's possible, you know, again, we have air resistance, drag, other things that'll complicate this analysis. So if we just ignore that and just basically focus on the simple case without any air resistance, then we'll get this result here. You know, and then if we have air resistance, then maybe we'll end up getting a path that looks more like this. And the point is, you know, maybe we don't go as far, as high, and we don't go as far. But in the absence of that, we'll get this nice, pretty plot. Okay. And again, part of that too would mean that maybe the speed that I have when I return here, both horizontally and vertically, maybe less than it was, than it should be in the ideal case. And that's because I've lost some speed due to friction, right? I'm encountering, or air resistance, right? I'm encountering, remember we talked about this in a previous episode, you know, because if I shoot a ball, that's going to be different than if I shoot an elephant, right? That's different area, even if I made, they had to have made them have the same mass, right? It's different area. Also, how fast it's going is going to affect air resistance. So a lot of more complicated analysis, but for us, not really something we need to concern ourselves with, more just to kind of know, okay, well, conceptually, what would happen, so, well, here's a question. What if I basically, you know, continue to fire a projectile faster and faster and faster? We call this a satellite, right? So if I imagine if I have the Earth here and I fire, you know, this thing like this, and then what if instead of just falling to the ground down here, it actually manages to, you know, if we say this is the Earth, it manages to stay in this what we call an orbit around the Earth. So this is a satellite. And again, it's a projectile that falls around the Earth instead of into it. Falling around instead of into it. And what this means is that its speed must be great enough so that its falling distance matches Earth's curvature. Right? Because if the Earth is curving away, let's look at a better drawing here. So the Earth is curving away like more circular, right? If the Earth is curving away like that, and if I'm not going fast enough, and so, you know, if I'm, say it's like this, but I'm not going fast enough, and I, because maybe if the Earth was smaller like this, I'd be fine. But because the Earth, is actually going all the way out here, its curvature is this. I'm not moving fast enough, and you know, the distance here that I fall is not, is too much. It's over, it's greater than the curvature of the Earth, and the way, than how much, you know, for every this distance, how much the Earth falls away. And so I'm going to hit the Earth. But if my distance is bigger, same out here, you know, then, well, I'm above the Earth, so my curvature, the rate at which I fall, is, I'm covering less vertical distance than the Earth is, and so I don't crash into the Earth. So that's really just, that's just really, so it all has to do with the speed. And the fact here is that for the Earth, for every 8,000 meters, the surface falls away at 5 meters. So what that means is, if we say, if this is our example, if this is 8 kilometers and this is 5 meters, so that's how much the Earth has fallen away, right? And so my satellite must be above this, must have not fallen a full 5 meters, otherwise it hit the ground, right? So maybe it's only fallen, you know, like 3 meters or something. So the point is, you have to fall, you can't, innate, if you basically have to be traveling fast enough so that you don't run into the Earth. That's all a satellite is. And to do that, this requires a speed, of 8 kilometers per second. That's in order to follow the curvature of the Earth. This, for those of us in the United States, is equivalent to 18,000 miles per hour. 18,000 miles an hour. That is hecka fast. Hecka fast. So, yeah, it's a very, very fast speed. Which is why, for most cases, if you just throw your pencil, there's no worry that it's going to become a satellite, right? It's going to eventually hit the Earth. Even if there was no friction, right? That would just end up with something like this. If there's gravity, then we're going to get something like this. If there's no gravity, well, then you can't orbit anyways because it's just going to go in a straight line. But so yeah, so that's pretty cool. And so there are sort of two main types of orbits. There are circular orbits. And so that's sort of the simplest case, right? If we imagine that I have the Earth here, and then an orbit like just a bigger, essentially a bigger version of this. Right, and then I imagine I have a little, object here. So that would be a circular orbit. It's a perfect circle. And so, I have some distance here, which is the radius of the Earth. And then I also have this distance here, which is there's additional height. And so together, the radius of the Earth and the height of, so the additional elevation above the Earth's surface, that's going to give me the radius of the orbit. And so it's just in that circle. And here's a question. How fast are you going in that orbit? Right, because we know you need at least 8 kilometers per second in order to not fall back into the Earth and continue moving. But what if I have it? So I'm in orbit like this. But what if I have an orbit that is, let's see, bigger like this? Or what if it's smaller? What's the speed of an object? In this case, and we'll color this one pink, and this one let's do purple. So, what's the speed difference for an object in the purple orbit versus the pink or the blue, right? So we can actually answer that, right? How? How can we answer? Well, we can use what we learned in chapter 8 on rotational motion. Right? We know that in each of these cases, there is a force due to gravity pointed towards the center of the Earth, right? And of course, and we know that this force from last time is g mass 1 mass 2 over the distance squared, r squared. And we know what the radius is. It's going to be the radius of the Earth plus some elevation. So we know the mass of the projectile and the mass of the Earth in this case. And so we can get the force. And so if we want to ask how fast, right? So that's going to be so cent that's so that's so this is going to be our centripetal centripetal velocity. And we know that that the centripetal force, right, is m v squared m v squared over r. And I'm just double checking myself because even I need to make sure that I am correct, because I don't want to make a mistake. Mv squared of r. Good. Okay. And that I'm saying here that the centripetal force is the gravitational force. So Fg provides centripetal force. So G M. And I'm going to call the test mass is M, and the Earth mass is going to be M sub E. So GM ME over R squared equals M V squared over R. I can, let's see, I can cancel the M's, I can cancel one of these R's. And I can take the square root, and I get that V equals the square root of G, mass of the Earth divided by R. And so this is the speed of a projectile. Speed of a projectile. Oh, it's a satellite, right? It's orbiting. So the speed of a satellite in a circular orbit. So there you go. And there are a couple of really important things to take away. Well, the first thing is that, which makes sense, right? V is proportional to the mass of the Earth, right? And that makes sense. You're orbiting a bigger body, you're going to have to be going faster in order to not crash into that body, because the force of gravity is stronger. So if the mass of the Earth were larger, then you'd have to be moving faster. Second thing is that it is proportional to 1 over r. And actually, here we should be specific. It's the square root of the mass and the square root, 1 over the square root of the radius. So what this means is that actually, as you get further away, the radius increases. And the radius increases, that means that this product here, g mass of the Earth over the radius, that's going to get smaller. And therefore, velocity must get smaller if the radius gets bigger. So what this means is that the pink orbit has slower speed than the purple because of the fact number two, that because there's in the definition of how of the speed of a satellite, I have a 1 over the square root of radius dependence. So that's really important. The third, and this is perhaps maybe the most intriguing thing, velocity is independent of our test mass. And this is crazy. So this means if I put an elephant or a pencil, we'll have same velocity for an orbit of the same radius, which is crazy, right? You might think that intuitively, if I put a heavier thing, maybe it's going slower. No, it's going at this, it's independent of mass. And think back again to all the way back to the beginning when we were dropping objects off of planes and things, or off the Tower of Pisa. In the absence of air resistance, the bodies would fall at the same rate. And that's all, this is essentially saying the same thing, right? The bodies are falling at the same rate, given this, given the particular radius that we're at. So that the those are sort of, I think, the three most important things to take into mind. And now, the other thing is that, which I think is really cool, is that it's possible. So there's a special type of circular orbit. It's called a geostationary orbit. And all this means is that the object is orbiting at at a given radius, such that the rate at which it orbits the Earth is exactly the same as which the Earth rotates on its axis, meaning it completes an orbit in 24 hours, just as the Earth does. And that means that it's always above the same point on the ground. And so this is how you can do satellite, like GPS or whatever. You're always above the same point on the ground 24/7 because you're moving at the exact same rate as the Earth is turning. So this just means it has a period of 24 hours. And a period is the time it takes to complete the orbit. And we can actually calculate this, right? Because we know, again, distance equals the rate times the time, right? So how far does a satellite have to travel? Well, it has to travel a circumference, right? It has to be the circumference. It's got to go right all the way around this circle back to where it started, and that's going to be a distance of 2 pi times its radius, and that has to equal, well, the rate. How fast is it going? Well, that's this, right? That's the speed of the satellite. So that must equal v times, well, how long does it take to go all the way around its orbit? That's the period, and we typically denote it with a big T. So in other words, then, the time, the period, is going to be 2 pi r over v. And so this is another good relationship to carry around with you. Because if you know the speed of the object and you know its and radius, you can calculate its period. And actually, because we know we can get the velocity from the radius, all you really need to know is how big is the object you're orbiting and how far are you from that object. And that will give you the period. So pretty cool. And again, this makes sense, right? Imagine, so if we have a satellite like the what about the the I think the space station, International Space Station, is pretty close to Earth. And so that only takes about 90 minutes, right? 90 minutes. And so, but if you're a geostationary orbit, you're really, really high. So you have a large radius. And you're also, again, dividing by velocity, which is going to be smaller because we already established with this relationship, the higher you are, the slower you're going. And so a big radius and a slow velocity mean a long time. So again, we can use this relationship to understand things, the properties about the orbit. Now, rarely is it ever so nice. In reality, most orbits are actually elliptical orbits. And all an ellipse is basically, instead of this is a circle, right? All that we do is we just, elongate it a bit. And I'm gonna just try and rotate it so it's a little, we elongate it a bit. And so instead of having one center, it has what are called two foci. And you might be learning about, in geometry class, you might be learning about these sort of different types of shapes. And so if you have a, you know, an orbit that's elliptical, then the planet here, the planet is always at one focus. And this is actually sort of a statement of one of Kepler's laws, which we'll look at in just a moment. So the planet is at one of these foci. And so let's talk about sort of what the motion of this object is going to look like. When we're really close to the planet, we're moving really fast, right? Because this, if you imagine that we were moving in a circle, right, of that radius, you know, then we're our radius is a lot closer, and so our speed, right, using this equation, radius is smaller, speed is going to be much greater. So we're going to be gaining a lot of speed. But when we're over here, this is really far away. It's a bigger distance. And so again, because of that equation, our speed is going to be slower. And so we're going to move slow, low, 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 fast, 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 low, 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 slow. And so that's going to be the resultant path. And in the absence of air resistance or friction or whatever, we're just going to continue in the same path forever and ever and ever. But in reality, we're going to, you know, maybe we come too close to the Earth's atmosphere and that slows us down or whatever. But if we ignore that, we're just going to go forever in this nice orbit. And so unlike the circular, in the circular case, it's moving at the same rate the entire time it's moving about the circle. But here, because we're an ellipse, right, we start here, we're moving slow, we start picking up more speed, go really, really fast, start slowing down. And then eventually we really, really slow down. And that's something that's really just important to keep in mind. Okay, and now, so, and the other actually cool thing is this gives us a perspective on the other cases of projectile motion we were looking at before. So if I have the Earth here, and let's say all those other cases where I didn't actually, you know, I fired it like this, but then I hit the Earth. Well, it's actually would be the rest of an ellipse. Right? It's actually going to be, it would make an orbit. The problem is I just run into the Earth and that stops those dreams. And so if, you know, somehow we were inside of the Earth or something and fired a cannonball, you know, around a little track, it would go in that track very nicely. It's just that, you know, if you run into the Earth, that kind of makes it hard. And again, the other key thing here with these ellipses to keep in mind is, there's this term called eccentricity. You might have heard like, oh, is someone eccentric, right? They're kind of out there. They're kind of weird, right? But no, cool. Like you want to be eccentric. That's good, right? So we don't want to just be like the rest of people, right? So, let's note with the letter E. So in the case of the circle, it's not eccentric. It's perfectly symmetric and good. Well, and circular, not symmetric. It's good. It is symmetric, but so is the ellipse. So is the ellipse. But it's perfectly, you know, each point around on the circle is the same distance from the center. That's its radius, and that's how we define a circle. But here, the eccentricity is bigger than zero, and the bigger the eccentricity, more stretched. So it's going to just become, you know, if we do this like more and more and more and more stretched, and it's going to get, you know, it's just going to get almost, it's going to eventually get to almost a flat line. I think actually this is each digit greater than one. Let me make sure. Eccentricity of a circle is right, is zero. Is zero. Greater than zero. And so, and there are actually these other shapes that will occur, other types of orbits, although they're not really, they're not a big focus for this class, but there are other types of shapes you can get. If the if our eccentricity is exactly one, we get a parabola. If the eccentricity is two, we get a hyperbola. And as I was saying, if eccentricity goes to infinity, then we're going to basically get a flat line. And so if the eccentricity is between zero and one, we're going to get an ellipse. If it's equal to one, we're going to get a parabola. Bigger than one, we're going to get a hyperbola. And so don't really worry. The point is just there are other types of orbits as well beyond just the circular. We can have an elliptical and then even a parabolic or a hyperbolic, maybe like an escape trajectory or something. So we can get some really cool stuff that will crop up. So yeah, that's just to show again how cool this really can all be. Now we and we sort of interpret all of this with what are I think really cool called these laws called Kepler's laws. And there are three laws. The first one says that the path of each planet around the sun, let's zoom out a little bit, is an ellipse with the sun at its center. Sorry, at one focus. And so that was what we were saying earlier. So if we have the sun here and the path of the planet is here, then there will be then the sun will be at one of those foci. And what Kepler observed, and we were kind of discussing earlier, right, is if I'm out here, I'm moving slow, but then I come in and I speed up, and then I slow down. And so what the question of why is this? Well, that's because of the conservation of angular momentum. And again, this gets a little bit more complicated, but so the second law basically says that the line from the sun to any planet sweeps out equal areas in equal times. And this is a consequence of the conservation of angular momentum. And so what that looks like is, okay, even though let's say I only, you know, between point A and B, actually we just copy this right here, duplicate down here. So this is saying is that between these two points, you know, let's say I'm only travel, I'm all, you know, I only travel this distance. Whereas over here, I'm traveling this bigger distance. What the second law of Kepler's laws is saying is that this area is actually equal to this area. So, and now it's important to note Kepler was just observing these things. He didn't know why this was happening. We know now, we know that this is actually a result of the conservation of angular momentum. But again, that's kind of something we don't need to go into right now. But the important thing to note is just again, that if I imagine I travel some distance and I basically make this triangle, then the area here, so I'm going to call this, this is A and this is B. So the area of A equals the area of B. That's what the second law is saying. And now the third law actually took him a long time. I think it was something like 10 years of trial and error. So that's dedication, right? The third law is about the period. He said that the square of the orbital period of a planet is directly proportional to the cube of the average distance of the planet from the sun. In other words, T squared is proportional to R cubed. And again, it's important to note that so these laws are a planetary motion. Planetary meaning that they apply to our planets that are about our planets orbiting the sun. But they also apply to any project or any satellite, right? Not necessarily projectile, but any satellite in orbit around a body. It just instead of the path of each planet around the sun, it'd be the path of each satellite around a body is an ellipse with the body at one focus, right? Or the planet or whatever. And this conservation of angular momentum, also the same. And this proportionality between the period and the radius, that is also the that also holds true. And so and so we can use those to do some interesting analysis as well. And the interesting sort of note the book makes, that was interesting, is that Kepler actually was familiar with Galileo's ideas about inertia, but he didn't apply them in his own work. He actually believed in Aristotelian motion, by the idea of natural versus violent motion, remember? He never really appreciated the concept of inertia. And of course, on the other hand, Galileo never appreciated Kepler's work and actually believed that the planets move in perfect circles. So, of course, we had to wait till Newton to integrate these ways of thinking together. So, kind of, yeah, a little bit interesting irony there, but that's what it is. The other really important piece of analysis is energy conservation. So we can use the conservation of energy to discuss, again, looking at the difference between a circular orbit and an elliptical one. Don't know why it kind of keeps rotating this on me. So, and that's our planet. Oops. Let's fix this. Okay. So in the circular orbit, at each of these points, right, the sum of potential energy and kinetic energy is the same, right? Because again, I'm not moving, I'm not changing my distance, I'm not changing my speed. And so the energy at each point is going to be constant. That's a feature of a circular orbit. However, if I make these sort of same points, here I have a small potential, but a big kinetic. I'm moving very fast. And in order that the total energy be conserved, right, I have small potential. I have a small distance above the planet. Here I have a little bit more medium between potential and kinetic. And then up here, I have a lot of potential and very small kinetic. I'm not moving very fast up here. And so this is, again, just a sort of looking at, how do these orbits, how do the orbits compare in terms of, if we're looking at circular versus elliptical in terms of speed at each different point in the orbit. And we can use energy conservation as another way of answering questions about, at what point, is the greatest speed, or whatnot, right? It's going to be, all sort of dependent on energy. So that's pretty cool. And now, what if we basically go too fast, even to orbit, right? Then that would be what's called escape speed. And that's basically where we just, so if we have here the Earth, and then, maybe we would, we could have a trajectory that would put us in an orbit. What if we go with such great speed that the trajectory just continues outward, never returns to the Earth? That's going to mean that the object has escaped. It's moved fast enough to escape the gravitational pull of the Earth. And for the Earth, that's about 11.2 kilometers per second. So really fast, really, really fast. And so we can answer a question like how much energy would it take for that to happen? And that's how we can actually calculate this escape speed. Because what we do is we assume that at infinity, right, at an infinite distance away, we just make the potential energy equal to zero. We make it zero. And so what that means is that all the other points, the potential energy is negative. So what this means is that what I want is all my kinetic energy will get converted into potential energy. So I think, yes, potential energy at infinity. Yes, zero to infinite distance. See, I have to check myself too, because there's so much that is going on. So I completely understand and identify you. And I'm a junior in college, right? So it's okay. It's okay. So what this is saying is, so we would have a 1/2 mv². Basically has got to let's see. So the force of gravity. So right. What this is saying is that, so the sum, the change in kinetic energy. So, if we start off with some initial potential, we start off with some speed. Basically, that's going to have to counteract the potential energy that it would take to move the object from wherever it is to an infinite distance away from the Earth. And so because the force of the gravity on the payload is strong only near the Earth, most of the work, right, is gonna occur within the first like 10,000 kilometers, So essentially what we're going to have to do is overcome work due to gravity to get it moved out essentially an infinite distance away, which is going to be only about 23 megajoules. So that's 23 or 63 rather times 10 to the 6, 63 million joules. So that's a big, big boy. But it's not infinite. There is a finite amount of energy. And you can then solve for, well, what kinetic energy would get me that potential energy? And you're going to end up with 11.2 kilometers per second. Now, to escape from the sun, escaping the sun is a bigger deal because you can escape the Earth, but then you're in an orbit around with the planets, and not the sun. And so escaping the sun is going to be, so our solar system is 618 kilometers per second. So there's a fun table actually in the book that has the escape speeds listed for different astronomical bodies. And it actually, what it tells you is that the escape speed is going to be the square root of 2gm over d. And so if you know d is the radius of the body, so if you know how big the object is and m is going to be the mass of the body, then that is going to give you the escape speed. And so if you know the different masses you and the radii, then you can plug that in and get the escape speed. And so that's, I think, really, really cool. So now let's just look at some sample problems. So this is going to be chapter 10, sample problems. And actually, they're in the book. Right after these problems, there's a practice test, and I highly encourage you to check that out, and talk with your friends about it. And yeah, just discuss the answers. And if you need any help, you know, comment below, and I will try to do my best to set you up for success. Okay, so problem number 35. So a ball is thrown upward at different velocities and angles, and we want to rank them by the vertical, horizontal components of velocity and the acceleration when they reach the top of the path. So what that is let's say, so I have 10 meters per second here, launched with an angle of 37 degrees. Here, double the starting speed, 20 meters per second, launched at a steeper angle of 53 degrees. B. C is again 10 meters per second, this time launched at 45 degrees. Actually, if I'm doing this, which I should be actually looking at the angles, so 53 is going to be more like that. Three degrees, and this is 20 meters per second. And here we have 10 meters per second going at a 45 degree angle. And here we have again 10 meters per second going at a shorter angle of 30 degrees. So what's the we want to rank by the vertical component of velocity, then the horizontal component of velocity, so same thing, and then acceleration at top of path. So take a moment and see if you can think about what these answers might be. So again, what we can do is use we can use vectors. And so basically what we can do is break it up, right? So what's the vertical and the horizontal component? So the vertical here for A is going to be, if we're using a right triangle, right? Well, this is going to be, so the A vertical is going to be 10 times the sine of 37 degrees. The B vertical is going to be 20 times the sine of 53 degrees. And I'm using the right triangle, right? And we know that sine is the opposite over hypotenuse. And so the hypotenuse is 10. The opposite is going to be the vector value that I want. And so we can use that relationship in order to get these vertical components. The C vertical component is going to be 10 times the sine of 45 degrees. And the D vertical is going to be 10 times the sine of 30 degrees. Now, you can put this on the calculator if you'd like. I'm going to try not to, because you don't. If you want to test, you want to go fast, might not have time. So the thing to remember about sine, right? So the sine function, it's going to start at zero. And then at 180 degrees, it's going to be zero. And then at 2 pi, or 360 degrees, it's going to be back to zero. And this is going to be at 90 degrees and 270 degrees. So the sine, so what we can see is, okay, well, this guy, we know B is going to be the biggest vertical, because the sine of 53 is going to be, in this range, and times 20, so that's going to be very big. Then let's look at these other guys. So what's the difference between 37, 45, and 30? Well, these are all sort of going up this way, and we know at 90, it's maximized. It's a value of 1 actually here, up at 90. So we can say then that because the angle, as the angle gets bigger, the sine will get bigger, and so the vector will get bigger. So because the next biggest is going to be the 45, so that's C, and then A, because that's 37. And the last one is going to be D, because that's only 30. So now for the horizontal component, we essentially do the same thing, except now we want A horizontal. And that's going to be similar, but now it's 10 times the cosine of 37 degrees. And cosine is going to be adjacent over hypotenuse. So that's going to give us this bit here. So 10 times the cosine of 37 degrees. The B horizontal is going to be 20 times the cosine of 53 degrees. C horizontal is going to be 10 times the cosine of 45 degrees. And the D horizontal is going to be 10 times the cosine of 30 degrees. And it's important to note that the cosine function is going to be different than the sine function. Cosine is going to start up maximized at 1 and then return up to 1. So this is at 0. And then at, at 90 degrees, it's like this. At 180, it's down there. And then at 270, it's crossed there. And then it's back to 1 at 360. So 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1. So it's opposite the sine. So let's see. So the cosine of 53 degrees, that's going to, so cosine, so that's, we're going to be looking in this region, right? Well, so again, because we're looking at 20, we're over double these, we are double, right? 20 versus 10. B is going to have the biggest horizontal component because it's got this 20. But for the 10s, we got to consider the angle. And so as the angle increases for cosine, the smaller the value gets, right? So now it's actually opposite. C is going to be highest. Well, I guess, the smallest angle is going to be biggest. So D is going to have the largest component because it's closest to this zero. And then C, because next it's at no, sorry. A, right? A, because that's the next big. So this is 30. That's D. Then A is 37 here. And then C is even further, 45. Like that. So they're, except B is different because it just got a lot bigger initial velocity. But when we take into account the angles for these guys, that's how it's going to stack up. So this is tricky. And you can also just use a calculator and not have to deal with these graphs. But I think it's kind of useful not relying on calculators, because then when you don't have them, then you're not stuck, right? What about the acceleration at the top of the path? Right, think about that. So we know in all these, right, we're going to sort of go like this. What's the acceleration going to be? What gives an acceleration, right? A force. What's the net force at the top of the path or anywhere? Well, for again, we break it up into components. That's what's super important. Horizontal, right? The sum of the forces in the x direction is zero. And we typically write this little x as a subscript. So the sum of the forces in the x direction is zero. There's nothing happened horizontally. So that is, there's no acceleration horizontally. So no horizontal acceleration. What about the vertical component? Well, the sum of the forces in the y direction is mg, right? It's the same for all of them. And so if they have the same, if it's the same ball, has the same mass, then the force is going to be the same. And thus, A equals B equals C equals D equals G. It's just acceleration due to gravity. So that was a big problem, but I think you should be really comfortable sort of dealing with, dealing with these trig functions, because that's going to allow you to think, talk about the different components of things, of velocities or forces. And then just remember again, if we break into components, we consider, say, the forces in the x direction, the forces in the y direction. And then remember that after I throw the ball, there's nothing acting on the ball in the horizontal direction except air resistance. But if we ignore air resistance, then we're fine. Except, and then, but in the y direction, there's gravity. And so we know there's going to be a vertical component of acceleration. So that's why, if you can, really get this idea of being able to componentize things, it's going to really, really help. Okay. Here's a question. Number 41. Suppose we roll a ball off a tabletop. Compared with the slow roll, so let's say this is slow versus, actually, let's say, so if it's slow, right, then it's not going to be moving very fast at all. It's kind of just like inching along. Whereas if it is moving fast and it's like in the same time, it's going a lot further. So compared with a fast or slow moving ball, which hits ground with higher speed? So think about that one for a second. Well, so again, with speed, what's important is there's going to be a horizontal and a vertical component, right? Those are the two things. So let's take the case of horizontal for a moment. Well, if in case A, this is the slow, and case B is fast, well, obviously the speed in the x direction for A is going to be less than the speed in the x direction for B, right? What about the vertical? Well, again, because they initially, no vertical motion for either, They're going to fall at the same rate vertically, and they're going to end up with the same final speed. So same, so the same y speed, because again, they have no initial vertical velocity. And because then the speed is going to be the horizontal plus the vertical, of course, in vector form, right? Because B has a greater x velocity than A, even though they have the same y, the combination of those two is going to actually mean that B has the greater velocity. So the fast one is going to hit the ground with the higher speed, because even though they fall at the same rate vertically, have the same vertical speed, this one has a faster component of horizontal velocity than the A does. And that means when I sum those two together, I'm going to get a bigger result, right? It's the difference of this plus this, which gives me this, versus this and this, which gives me that. Right? It's just this has got a bigger length than this one. Okay, problem 43. So let's say we have a plane, and I drop a heavy crate, and there's a car that's sitting below it. Relative to the car, where does the crate land? So, and of course, this plane has some velocity that way. So take a moment and think about this. So, well, you might expect that this just falls straight down, right? And that's true. It does fall down because of gravity, but it's also got this horizontal component. And so the combination of its motion is this sum of horizontal and vertical component. And so it's going to end up tracing out a path that looks like this, like a parabola. So it's going to fall safely away from the car because, again, of inertia. It's moving to the left here with some speed. It's not going to just, that speed is not just going to evaporate. It has that speed. It's going to be moving that way. And then it's also moving down. And so the combination of those two produces this parabola. Okay. So let's say, problem 51, right? We fire a projectile straight upwards at 141 meters per second. That's pretty fast. How fast is it moving at the top of its trajectory? And then what about if we launch it at 45 degrees? Same question. How fast is it going at the top of its trajectory? Well, in this case, right, if it's just moving vertically, it's going to come up and then eventually it's going to just stop and then fall back down. So it's actually moving not at all up at the top here, but it will be moving at 141 meters per second times the sine of 45 degrees, because again, have to actually, it doesn't, even though sine and cosine here doesn't matter, strictly it's cosine, because 45 degrees cosine and sine are equal. Even though its vertical component is zero, it still has the horizontal component of 141 times the cosine, right, this part here, of 45 degrees. And actually, I should have drawn this a bit better. It's going up like this, 141 meters per second, and this is 45 degrees. And so this is our x, and that's our y. So because it actually has some initial horizontal velocity, that's just going to keep going. And again, that's not going to go away because there's no force acting horizontally. Okay, what about number 65? So we have a sketch of a ball on a plane. It's got some force due to gravity, mg. And then, but there's a component of the gravity that acts in the direction of motion that provides work, does work. So what if the question is we have an ellipse, elliptical orbit, planet here, and we know we feel this force of gravity here. What's the component that works to change the kinetic energy of the satellite? Well, so the satellite is wanting to move, let's say, like this. And I know that the gravity is slowing it down. So it's going to be this component of the force here, this sort of almost like a vertical, I guess, that is going to act against this direction of motion to provide negative work and slow down the projectile. Okay, question 72. How could an astronaut in space drop an object vertically to Earth? So if I have, you know, the Earth here and then, you know, my little space station, something like that, right? How could I drop an object vertically to Earth? Well, what I could do is slow it down, right? If I have a little booster or something and I let's say I'm moving this way, I counteract that speed. And so instead of then continuing in this nice, you know, circular path or whatever, or elliptical, I actually then am coming down here. I'm going to be slowing it down. And then actually I'll show a clip of this game called Kerbal Space Program, which is really cool. If you're into rockets and physics and that kind of thing, you'll really like this game. This clip of this orbit slowing down in orbit, because it's then going to, it was a nice orbit, but now because I'm burning against the way I'm moving, I'm slowing myself, am I moving this way? I'm burning, you know, the rocket is exhausting that way, which is going to slow me down. And what was this nice orbit here is going to eventually no longer make it all the way around the Earth, and I'm going to end up smacking down on the Earth. And so that's how you would stop a satellite. You have to basically cancel out a lot of its velocity so that it actually can intersect the Earth. Okay. So let's look at question 82. So if I have an ellipse like this, sun like that, I have these four places. And I ask about acceleration of Earth towards sun. Now, the thing is, we know that the force of gravity is going to provide the centripetal force, and that's going to be g m1 m2 over the radius squared. And so actually the force of gravity felt by the projectile by this object is not going to be the same at each of these places, because the radius is different. Like here there's a distance, here that's a bigger that's a bigger distance, this is a bigger distance, and that's even bigger. So the closer you are, the more gravity you'll feel. And thus, because force of gravity divided by the mass, let's do M1, that's going to give us the acceleration. So A is going to have the biggest acceleration, followed by B, followed by D, followed by C. So how close you are impacts the force of gravity, and that's going to impact your acceleration. Two more problems I think are kind of interesting. This one is almost a riddle. You can ask your friends, which two planets are never seen at midnight and why? Okay, think about this for a second. Well, let's say we have the solar system like this. Well, what are the orbits? Well, we have We have Mercury and then Venus and then Earth, right? And then a bunch of other stuff, right? Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, etc. Neptune, Pluto. Although Pluto's a dwarf planet, not Pluto. So if at midnight you're facing away from the sun, right? You're facing out, I'll do it a different color so it's clear. You're facing this direction. So no matter where Mars and Venus are, you won't be able to see them because they're both within the orbit of the Earth. Now, you could potentially see, Mars because Mars could be out here, and this could be within, your cone of vision. But you're never going to see Mars or Venus at midnight because at midnight you're facing away from directly away from these orbits. Last problem, number 95. Can a satellite maintain an orbit in the plane of the Arctic Circle? This is a kind of weird one. So think for a second about this. Well, okay. If this is the Earth, the question is, could I orbit around it like that? The answer is no. And this is because an orbit, to be an orbit, must pass around the center of the object. Really, I guess you could think of it like the center of mass of the object. And so because the center of mass is going to be down here, I would need an orbit that passes around that. Maybe goes around like this, or even like that. Those are all good. But because they pass around the center of the Earth, and even this is all circular, but if I had some crazy elliptical thing, that would be fine too, because the Earth would be at one of those foci. But so it's not possible to just sort of circle around here because you're not going around the center of mass, and it's just not possible to have that orbit. All right, well, congratulations. That's the last problem we'll consider for the semester, at least in this video series. Congratulations, you really worked hard, you earned it. Study for your finals, and may the force be with you. And if you have any questions, please just leave it in the comment, or if you want me to, go over any problems, or you have other questions, just let me know, and I'll do what I can. All right, well, good luck, everybody.